the Bobby Franks killing case by two wealthy and intelligent teenagers, Leopold and Lou, sequentially having 210 and 169 IQ. Its remark is one of the biggest crimes and trial of the century. How did they plot their murder and what happened at the court trial that case plea is dubbed as the best plea by the defense attorney Clarence Darrow? On November 19, 1904, Nathan Leopold was born in Chicago to wealthy German Jewish immigrant Florence and Nathan Leopold. Leopold was a prodigy youngster who claimed to have spoken his first word at the age of 4 months. Leopold has received Phi Beta Kappa honors from the University of Chicago and planned to attend Harvard Law School after a tour to Europe. Meanwhile, on June 11, 1904, Richard Lowe was born in Chicago to Anna Henrietta and Albert Henry Lowe, a wealthy lawyer and retired vice president of Sears, Roebuck & Company. His mother was Roman Catholic and his father was a Jew. Lowe, like Leopold, was gifted with extraordinary intelligence. He skipped several grades in school and graduated from the University of Michigan at the age of 17 with the help of his governess. He was particularly interested in history and was studying at the University of Chicago for graduate work. Unlike Leopold, Lowe was less interested in academic pursuit, preferring instead to socialize, play tennis, and read mystery novels. With their different families, the two young men grew up in the affluent Kenwood area on the Chicago South Side. The Lowes had the summer residence in the Charlevoix, Michigan, today known as Castle Farms, and a mansion in Kenwood, just 2 blocks from the Leopold house. Though Leopold and Lowe had known each other briefly as children, their connection blossomed at the University of Chicago in the mid of 1920s. Especially once they discover a shared interest in crime. They share an interest in philosopher Friedrich Nietzsche during their teens, particularly his concept of the Übermensch, a picture of the perfect, superior man, one who rises beyond ordinary life in order to invent and impose his own exalted immorality on humanity, a superhero to be precise. The two buddies were utterly charmed with the concept of superior creature, even believing that they belonged to this magical group, which meant they weren't subject to the same ethic and laws as ordinary human. Leopold even indicated as much on one of his letters to Lowe. A Superman is one account of certain superior qualities inherent in him, exempted from the ordinary laws which govern men. He is not liable for anything he may do. The two genius boys were Yin and Yang. Leopold was the introspective and academically voracious half, and Lowe was the outgoing and socially savvy half. As a result, they fed off each other and developed a friendship so strong that they became sexually intimate with each other. The pair began putting their philosophical theory into practice by committing a series of minor crimes, mostly petty theft and vandalism. Encouraged by their successes, they increased the stake to more serious misdemeanors, such as arson, but it wasn't enough. Their ravenous hunger for recognition wasn't being satisfied because the press was ignoring the crimes. Leopold and Lowe, now 19 and 18, agreed to commit one of the most heinous crimes against humanity. Murder. They knew it would get a lot of attention, and it would give them a chance to prove their words by planning the perfect crime. Over the course of 7 months, they meticulously planned every detail to ensure their success. On the afternoon of May 21, 1924, Leopold and Lowe drove their rental cars through the street of Chicago South Side looking for possible victims. They were ready to call it a day on the kidnapping at 5 p.m. after a two-hour drive around Kenwood. However, as Leopold drove north as Ellis Avenue, Lowe, in the backseat, noticed his cousin, Bobby Franks, walking south on the opposite side of the road. Bobby always played tennis with Lowe's brothers at his house. Bobby's father was a wealthy businessman, and he will be able to pay the ransom. He patted Leopold on the shoulder to let him know that they located their prey. Leopold swung the car around in a loop and drove slowly along Ellis Avenue, gradually catching up to Bobby. Bobby was then contacted by Lowe, who offered to give him a ride home. Bobby, on the other hand, shook his head and said he could walk because he was almost home. Bobby has just purchased a new tennis racket, and Lowe insists on speaking with him about it. Bobby had gotten a little closer now. He was standing by the car's side. Through the open window, Lowe observed him. Bobby was so close to entering. Lowe could have grabbed him and dragged him inside, but he kept talking in the hopes of persuading the child to take the front seat. Bobby took a step onto the running board. Bobby slid into the front passenger seat close to Leopold, with the front passenger door open, welcoming the boy inside. Lowe made a motion toward his companion and asked if he knew Leopold. Bobby cast a sidelong glance and shook his head, as if he didn't recognize him. Bobby shifted in his seat to face Lowe, smiling at his cousin with an open, innocent grin, ready to talk about his tennis victory the day before. The automobile accelerated slowly down Ellis Avenue. Lowe searched the car seat next to him for the chisel as it crossed 49th Street. They taped up the blade blunt end and handle, so that it could be used as a club. It was in Leopold's hand. He took a firmer grip on it. Leopold turned the car left at 50th Street. Bobby turned his gaze away from Loeb and toward the front of the car as it reached the corner. Loeb leaned over the edge of the seat. With his left hand, he grabbed Bobby from behind and covered his mouth to keep him from weeping. He slammed the chisel into the back of the boy's skull with force. He hammered the chisel into the youngster's head with all his might once again, yet the boy remained conscious. Bobby had twisted halfway around his seat, facing Loeb and desperately extending his arm as though to defend himself from the blows. Loeb smashed the chisel into Bobby's forehead two more times, but he was still fighting for his life. The boy's forehead had been gashed by the fourth hit. The blood from the wound splattered across the seat, splashed down Leopold's leg, and spilled onto the floor. Bobby's continual consciousness was unfathomable to Loeb. Loeb leaned down and abruptly yanked Bobby over the front seat and into the back of the car. He stuffed a towel down the boy's throat as forcefully as he could. He taped the mouth shut with a huge length of adhesive tape that he tore off. The boy had stopped whimpering and wailing. Loeb let go of his grasp. Bobby slipped from his lap and folded up at his feet. After that, the youngster was gagged and died not long after. They took Bobby's body to a planned dumping location 25 miles south of Chicago, stripped him, and poured hydrochloric acid on his face and genitals to cover the fact that the youngster had been circumcised, a clear indication that he was Jewish. After that, they stuffed his body into the culvert and drove away. They got home, threw away their blood-stained clothes, and washed the blood of the car upholstery before spending the rest of the night playing cards. Little Bobby had already been reported missing by the time they had arrived home. The boy's body was discovered soon later, and their plan for getting ransom was cancelled. They disposed of any residual evidence linking them to the crime and resumed their normal life. During this time, Leopold kept his head down, while Loeb was drunk on bravado, speak freely to reporters and detectives. He even said, "If I were to murder anybody, it would be just such a cocky kid as Bobby Franks." When a pair of spectacles was discovered near Bobby's body, the wagon began to break apart. Even though the frames and prescription were standard, the hinges were one of a kind, with just 3 persons in Chicago having acquired them, one of whom was Leopold. He was questioned about it, but said that he had dropped them after a weekend spent bird watching. The explanation wouldn't last long though, as the ransom notes wrapped typewriter was discovered in a lagoon, prompting both men to be interrogated. They made up a flimsy alibi about picking up a woman on the night of the murder. But Leopold Chauffeurs testified that his car was in for the maintenance that night. They had no choice but to confess after their lies were exposed. They each maintained, however, that the other was the murderer and that they were simply the driver. They also admitted to doing the crime for the thrills, and Leopold was anxious to see how murderer felt, expressed his disappointment when he felt no difference afterwards. The trial that followed was labeled the trial of the century, and the Loebs engaged famed defense lawyer Clarence Darrow for $17,000, the equivalent of $1 million in 2020. Darrow, an ardent opponent of capital punishment and aware that they would face terrible punishment regardless, crafted a case based on a plea of not guilty by reason of insanity, hoping for a life sentence rather than a death penalty. Darrow's piece de resistance was a 12-hour plea, one that has been called the finest of his career. Its principal theme was the inhuman method and punishment of the American justice system and the youth and the immaturity of the accused, saying that all this happened due to the war that happened around them, making them to act wild, and blaming the university for using Nietzsche philosophy that they learned at the university. The 32-day trial finished in September 1924, when the court, pressed by Darrow's argument, sentenced them both to prison, to life in prison, plus another 99 years for the kidnapping. Both were sentenced to prison, and Loeb father died of heart failure a month later, while Loeb would only live for another 12 years, dying at the age of 30 after a horrific attack by the fellow inmates in which he was sliced 58 times with a razor. Following his incarceration, Leopold's tale is exceptional for crime of his class as he became a model prisoner. He worked to improve jail conditions by organizing the library, revamping the school system and teaching pupils, as well as volunteering at the prison hospital. During this period, he also published his autobiography, Life Plus 99 Years. He was released after multiple parole denials and 33 years in prison, and shortly thereafter attempted to establish a charity using his revenues from his book. The Leopold Foundation intended to be established to aid emotionally troubled, impaired, and delinquent youngsters. However, his charter was revoked because it would have violated his parole restriction. The Veterans Service Commission, a Christian charity, provided him with a house and a job as a medical technician at its hospital in Puerto Rico. After that, he moved to Puerto Rico, married 3D Feldman, a florist, and earned a master's degree from the University of Puerto Rico. He went on to become teacher and later a researcher for a social service organization. He also undertook research on leprosy and worked for an urban renewal and housing agencies. Then, at the age of 66, he died of a heart attack brought on by his diabetes, and his corneas were subsequently donated. Till now, the court result for not giving death penalty to Leopold and Loeb for their wrongdoing is still questioned and stay controversial as ever by people around the world, moreover by the Bobby Franks family itself. Who would have thought that his own cousin and friends will kill their son solely for attention?